3,100 tow planes and gliders were in on it. Like we always did. Down to meet us was the Navy. Our first meeting since D-Day. We all got a bang out of watching the United States Navy romping around in the German Rhine. Well, maybe romping isn't the word. The crossing might have been a pushover some places. At other points, the Kraut was pretty sore about his sacred German river and all that sacred German soil behind it. We crossed the Rhine and got onto the sacred soil in a hurry because we had an appointment with the airborne. They were coming over in droves. We heard that the airborne was using a few new wrinkles and tricks of their own on this trip. Ways to speed up landings. Were secure, and the engineers had worked out some new twists too, besides using the old ones for getting more manpower over. Pontoon bridges were speeding tanks and guns to the other side. That knockout punch, all right, and there was plenty of steam behind it. Between you and me, it was going faster than scheduled. Some of us had even reached our objectives before the time set up for our meeting with the airborne. Heinies were deciding that a soldier's life isn't the easy way to make a living. There were so many, it seemed like Adolf couldn't have any left, and that he'd really scraped the bottom of the barrel this time. Old guys and kids and whatever the Krauts call their 4Fs, along with the trained killers.
Oh.
pouring in from all over the countryside with all the fight out of them. Glad to be in one piece and happy to lie around, meek and quiet in the sun. Little lost sheep. Little lost black sheep. The old lesson of resist and be smashed had to be taught to another corner of the Germany that was going to last 1,000 years. Some towns caught on fast, and when the Wehrmacht cleared out, the Volksstürmers threw away their guns and went back to their shops. But others didn't. The homes of millions had been crushed like this, and these same people had laughed and cheered. Now German women were learning to cry, like the women of all those other countries. London, Warsaw, Rotterdam, Stalingrad, and all the others were being brought home to the people of Wesel, the people of Würzburg, the people of Essen. Essen, where the Krupp family had manufactured all that death and destruction. The planes which had carried so much of that death and destruction littered the country wherever we went. The records of what had been the world's most modern military equipment. But what was left of it wasn't so modern. Kaput, too, was the manpower that had operated all those planes and all that equipment. Getting close to the final curtain. There were some people along the way who were really glad to see us. Our own, of course. The men who had been behind wire fences. Some for 3 and 4 years. For many of them, we'd come too late. None of us would forget what we saw behind those wires. Germans worked next to them in factories and fields, saw them marched from and to the camps each day, helped guard them. But you couldn't find a single Heine who knew what was going on. There they were, starved, beaten, tortured, and killed. But nobody had done it. It was just some of that wicked anti-Nazi propaganda. We got to some camps in time to pull out men who might have a little more of living ahead of them. But only a little, and it wouldn't really be living. Adolf had ended poverty in Germany. For Germans. We knew how. With the slave market ended and nobody to steal from now, what were the nice Germans going to do?